Guys, it's a great day to have a great day because the Richmond Flying Squirrels have fallen right in line with state regulations, so that means we could be at full capacity for tonight's game against the Altoona Curve. Through protocols, positive tests, and quarantines, the best two teams in college basketball have reached the finish line. Success has put Washington in a much different position than a year ago. Instead of having the second overall pick and pretty much knowing that Chase Young was their guy, the NFC East champs will select 19th this year. It's not a surprise that a Curry stepped up in an NBA playoff game, but it was Seth, not Steph, that was the difference maker for the Sixers tonight. Guys, the Dukes are in the Women's College World Series for the first time, and they proved today that they belonged. JMU knocked off top seed Oklahoma 4-3 in 8 innings to open the double elimination tournament. Sarah Jubas hit a 3-run home run to give the Dukes the lead. Then after Oklahoma tied it, Kate Gordon hit a solo home run to give the Dukes the lead for good. Zach Jones is on the verge of a life-changing moment. The Richmond native will make his NHL debut for the New York Rangers tonight against the Flyers. Jones was drafted in 2019 but opted to continue in college. Good move. He just won a national title with UMass Amherst and signed with the Rangers 9 days ago. Bubba Wallace was in town last week to test NASCAR's next-gen car. It's been a busy year already for Wallace with a new team and a fresh set of expectations.
Excited for the direction that NASCAR is heading.
Alex Bowman came out of nowhere to earn the checkered flag at Richmond Raceway. Bowman surged past Denny Hamlin with 10 laps to go after a restart. Bowman clinches a spot in the playoffs, whereas Hamlin leaves his home track frustrated.
Yeah, we should have won. Certainly the 48 wasn't better than us all day, but just got to lead the last lap. You got to figure out how to lead the last lap, and that's pretty much all that matters. But today, obviously, I don't know, we had a dominant car. I mean, it was definitely top two.
Hamlin won both of the first two stages and was battling Joey Logano for the lead late, but a caution changed everything for Hamlin and for Bowman.
We drove away from him. I was like, oh my gosh, what's happening? Obviously, we had some really fast laps there, and I was super loose the last couple laps and did my best to give it back away, but we just really improved the race car there and had a lot of grip taken off.
Hamlin is still first in the point standings, but has not yet won in 2021. At Richmond Raceway, Natalie Kalibat, 8 Sports. The gap between victory and defeat could not be tighter for the Capitals and Bruins. Game 2 tonight was the 9th straight playoff game between the two teams that was decided by exactly one goal. Caps down 1-0, but not for long. TJ Oshie scores the power play goal 6.5 minutes into the game. Bruins would score again, and the Capitals answered. Garnett Hathaway puts away his first of the playoffs. Then we fast forward to the third period, and there he is again. Hathaway lights the lamp 3-2 Capitals, but the Bruins would tie it late and got the game winner in OT from Brad Marchand. The series is all tied up at a game apiece heading back to Boston. Baylor's title defense is going pretty well. The second-seeded Bears had their way with number 7 Virginia Tech tonight, 90-48. Baylor scored the game's first 7 points and built a 17-9 lead after one quarter. Then they turned on the Jets in the second quarter, outscoring the Hokies 27-11. Baylor was just too big, getting to the rim at will and out-rebounding Virginia Tech 53-23. Kenny Brooks' team wraps up with a 15-10 record. Washington had a golden opportunity to extend its East Division lead tonight, but it all fell apart late. The Caps led 2-0 in the first period thanks to goals from TJ Oshie and Nick Dowd. But the Rangers dominated from there. New York got one goal back in the first period, then exploded for 4 more in the third. Errors proved costly for Peter Laviolette's team. 7 races, 7 different winners. Change has been the story in NASCAR in 2021, and that continued at Bristol as an old surface, dirt, provided a new challenge. This time, it was Joey Logano taking the checkered flag. Logano passed Daniel Suarez late in the second stage and kept the lead the rest of the way, despite a late push from Denny Hamlin. It was the final day of the regular season, but we got some late drama worthy of the playoffs from the Capitals and Bruins. Scoreless in the second period, Jared Tenorti skated to the net and passed the puck across the crease to Curtis Lazar, who gave the Bruins a 1-0 lead. Caps respond, though. Garnett Hathaway goes for it. Carl Hagelin knocks it in. The rebound to tie it up at 1 apiece. With just under 5 seconds left to play, Michael Roffel wastes no time, clears the shot from that angle. Are you kidding me? The Caps finished the regular season beating the Bruins 2-1. The ACC tournament in Charlotte opened with a Commonwealth clash, and it was number 8 Virginia getting the better of number 12 Virginia Tech in Pool A play. The Cavaliers took control of the game early, scoring on a sacrifice fly by Jake Geloff in the second inning. Then Kyle Teal delivered the big blow in the third. A 2-run home run gave the Hoos a 3-0 lead. The Hokies would get 2 runs back on a Tanner Showball home run in the 6th, but UVA earns the 3-2 win. Brian O'Connor's team faces number 1 Notre Dame to close out pool play on Friday at 11 a.m. This Memorial Day weekend, we remember those who have served and sacrificed their lives for our freedom. During Sunday's Coca-Cola 600, Ross Chastain's number 42 car will carry a special meaning for one local family.
For those of us that have lost somebody, it's a special day.
For Vera Adcock and her husband Maris, Memorial Day is about honoring their son Shane, who was killed while serving in Iraq in 2006. Brian Jalbert, Shane's best friend from Atlee High School, is an avid racing fan. He saw drivers paying tribute to veterans on their cars and reached out to NASCAR hoping they could do the same for Shane. Shane will be honored on the number 42 of Ross Chastain at the Coca-Cola 600 a week after his 42nd birthday. What does that mean to you both?
That is just so unbelievable. When we figured out that it was number 42 and Shane would be turning 42, we were just shocked. We're like, God has quite a sense of humor.
We've seen a lot of young men and women find their salvation through what has happened. It's been quite interesting and quite compelling to watch that over the years, and we continue to support the Wounded Warriors and the different programs and the soldiers, because I know that's what Shane would have wanted.
Ross, what does it mean to be a part of this?
This weekend, Memorial Day, the basis of it is to look back and to look at the people that have voluntarily went and paid that ultimate sacrifice. I hope that, you know, saying his name and for his family and for his friends, is it helps, and it's a reason to smile.
What would Shane's reaction be looking down with his name being honored on Ross Chastain's car?
He would be going, awesome. Yeah. He would really be thinking that it's too big of a deal, but yet he'd be loving every minute of it. He was one of those people, he loved the spotlight, but he didn't seek it out, if that makes sense. He just kind of walked into the room and commanded your attention.
Under the bright lights of Charlotte Motor Speedway, all eyes will be on the name of Shane Adcock again. Phil Mickelson wasn't supposed to do this, but the 115th ranked golfer in the world showed that he could be great one more time.
The 2021 PGA champion, Phil Mickelson.
History made. 50-year-old Phil Mickelson becoming the oldest golfer ever to finish first in a major.
This is just an incredible feeling, because I just believed that it was possible, but yet everything was saying it wasn't. And I hope that others find that inspiration, but gosh, is it worth it in the end?
Davis Love III, a PGA Championship winner in his own right, wasn't surprised.
It just proves that the golf ball doesn't know how old you are, and he's one of the best players ever. He's in the Hall of Fame, got in before me, younger than me. There's a reason why he's successful. He works very hard at it. I'm thrilled for him and his family, and it inspires me.
Love, who won the event in 1997, reached out after Lefty's major moment.
Well, I texted Phil last night and I said, nothing amazes me from you. He's such a show off. He's so confident.
Love said that Mickelson's consistency, especially recently, is what impresses him the most.
Really, he was in it all week, and that's what's amazing is I think he was leading the first day or right near the lead, and he sustained it. But he did that in Charlotte just a few weeks ago. He started off in the lead, so he's been playing well, and he kept saying it, I'm really close. So I guess he's not close anymore. He's a major champion again.
Love III, the driving force behind the newly reopened Belmont Golf Course, is hoping to develop golfers of all ages and levels here after partnering with First Tee Greater Richmond.
But it's just great that the community gets behind not only such a great charity, a great organization, the First Tee, but they're also behind their golf. This Belmont has so much golf history for such a long time, major championships, city championships. people growing up playing here, it was a shame that it might go away. So the vision to put some new life into Belmont and give it a new purpose, I think it's going to be one of the neatest projects that I've ever been involved with.
Christopher Bell is one of NASCAR's brightest young stars, and there's a Virginian making sure that Bell shines. His car chief, Portsmouth native Chris Sherwood.
My favorite memory probably of Richmond is when I finally got my chance to car chief in the Xfinity side for Bell, and we won that race two times, the beginning of the chase both times.
Sherwood and Bell made a great team earlier this year too, as the second year driver clinched a playoff spot with a win on the Daytona road course.
Getting just all that pressure on himself and capitalizing when we had to, because I mean, look at it now, there's so many winners and we're one of them, so that's what it takes to make the playoffs.
Sherwood's stepfather was also a car chief for Ward Burton.
Him teaching me along the way, I mean, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for him, because everything that I learned came through him directly. And, you know, I looked at myself that, you know, when I was in high school, and I was like, that's the job I want.
When Sherwood decided to follow in his footsteps, his dream team was an easy choice.
Joe Gibbs Racing was the place to be. Treats his workers fair, you know, everything about him, he's just top of the notch.
Opening day meant more to Flying Squirrels vice president and general manager Ben Rothrock. It was the first Squirrels game since he had open heart surgery in January of 2020.
The whole last year was just a totally different game, and you know, it was the game of life, and I had to do so many things just to survive.
So Ben, how have you been able to cope with everything that's happened?
You know, there's so many challenges that we had to overcome, and to be able to take a step into what now is the future and to realize where you've been and now where you're going. And, you know, it's going to be fun, it's going to be exciting, and we're ready.
The health scare combined with a season without baseball has made Rothrock grateful for what he has.
You want to just embrace every single day, and I do. I embrace the challenge of preparing for a season. I embrace the ability to spend time with my wife and my kids. And, you know, that's something that I'll never take for granted ever again.
Every domino had to fall at the right time. That's how Chesterfield native Denny Hamlin describes his path to NASCAR. With Mother's Day and the race at Darlington on deck, Denny and his mother Mary Lou reflected on their journey.
I was very, very blessed to be in the situation I was. I had instrumental people throughout my childhood that believed in me and gave me an opportunity and kept me racing.
Hamlin became more than a driver this year, joining with Michael Jordan to launch 2311 Racing. And of course, his family was very involved with the process.
The most pushback probably came from my dad, because he probably wrote most of those checks back in the day. And you know, he's like, you know, are you sure, you know, you can do this and whatnot?
Mom didn't have any doubts, though.
He makes good decisions. He studies things. And it just amazed me that he had gotten this far. So proud of him.
Hamlin leads the point standings, but hasn't reached victory lane yet in 2021. It would be quite the Mother's Day present on Sunday. Naomi Sadler carries a famous last name in Virginia sports, but while her father, Hermie, and Uncle Elliot found success on the racetrack, Naomi's doing it on the diamond, something that she's thrilled to continue in college.
Softball is what I started with when I was younger, and I've just always had a love for it, and I always will have a love for it. And I'm so excited to be able to continue that love over the next 4 years at Randolph-Macon.
Naomi Sadler, a multi-sport athlete, had to narrow it down to one, but it wasn't a hard choice. Her passion for softball stems from a young age.
I've been playing softball since I was, I started with T-ball when I was like 3 years old, and I've been playing travel softball since I was like 7 or 8 years old. And I've always enjoyed other sports, but softball has always been like what I've loved the most.
That love combined with plenty of effort has paid off, according to her father, former NASCAR driver Hermie Sadler.
This is the culmination of many, many years of hard work and back and forth trips to ball games day and night, a lot of school ball, a lot of travel ball, and most importantly, a lot of hard work by Naomi to get her to this point. So we want to celebrate her and her accomplishments here, and also look forward to the next chapter, which are what we hope are going to be four great years at Randolph-Macon?
I chose Randolph-Macon because of the academics as well as being able to further my athletic career. And it's also really close to home, and it's kind of still got that small school feel. It's not too overwhelming. They have a great coaching staff up there. I've met a lot of the girls. They're all really great, and I'm just really excited.